Good evening. The current conflict in Northern Ireland has now lasted for nearly 10 years. For much of that time, politicians in the Irish Republic have refrained from questioning Ulster's status as part of the United Kingdom. But after a sweeping victory in Ireland's general election last summer, Prime Minister Jack Lynch has once again called on the British government to commit itself to the reunification of Ireland.
Do you believe that there can be permanent peace in Ireland as long as Britain remains in the north?
I honestly don't believe that there could be, because there will be, in future generations, people who are prepared to take up arms, even though they won't have the support of the vast majority, to take up arms in such a situation. And the history of Ireland as a whole, and particularly the history of Ireland since partition was imposed in 1920, has been that in every decade there has been outbreaks, there have been outbreaks of violence, and unfortunately in this decade the outbreak has lasted almost the entire decade. There is a grave danger that that kind of thing would continue, would recur.
But politicians of the major Protestant party in the north, the Ulster Unionists, resent the intrusion.
What is your reaction to what Mr. Lynch has been saying?
Well, one of detestation. We're horrified at the intrusion that he is having into Northern Ireland affairs in recent months. Certainly he gives the impression of being a man who politically is trying to cash in on the terrorist campaign, instead of pursuing policies to defeat terrorism, pursuing policies of cooperation with Northern Ireland. He is giving the incentive to terrorism by saying that there cannot be peace until there is a united Ireland, and that encourages terrorism.
And what it reflects, I think, is several factors. First of all, a sense of frustration at the lack of any movement in Northern Ireland and a feeling that we should be looking around for some way to break the deadlock. Also the fact that throughout all the period of recent years, we've been inhibited a bit from looking seriously at this question of the shape of United Ireland, because there's always been some negotiation going on or something that might be about to happen, and one doesn't want to do anything to damage it or spoil it. At the moment, there is, in fact, deadlock.
At the moment, the political deadlock is overshadowed by the problem of security. It is this that occupies the government's mind. The provisional IRA's renewed offensive has claimed the lives of 26 people since Christmas. Currently, there are 14,000 British troops in Northern Ireland, a security operation costing the British taxpayer hundreds of millions of pounds a year. The political deadlock exists because power sharing, which for the past 5 years has been the cornerstone of British government policy, has not proved to be practical politics. Power sharing is the system whereby Ulster is given back responsibility for running its own affairs, provided the Protestant majority agrees to share power with the Catholic minority. The political leaders of the Protestant majority have, except for a few months in 1974, steadfastly refused to accept power sharing, convinced that it opened the back door to the Republican enemy. They now believe that Britain has given up hope of imposing it.
Is power sharing dead?
Oh, certainly, yes. I think this is now recognised by all outside observers in Northern Ireland. The Alliance Party accepts that it's dead. The British Conservative Party accepts that it's dead. We ourselves, of course, have rejected it time after time in Northern Ireland. So it's no longer a political issue here.
Even the Alliance Party, which has made power sharing the foundation of its policies, has few illusions.
Is power sharing dead?
For the moment, I'm afraid it is. First of all, the official unionists are quite adamant that they are not going to agree to a power-sharing form of government. It goes without saying that Paisley won't agree. But the SDLP have significantly shifted their emphasis over the last number of months, more and more to the Irish dimension and declaration of British withdrawal, and a less and less profile on the question of partnership within Northern Ireland. I suspect they've simply thrown their hand in on that one. So at the moment, it isn't practical politics.
In fact, a recent ORC opinion poll for Ulster Television shows that 63% of the people in Northern Ireland want power sharing, but it cannot be achieved.
That is why the SDLP, the party that most Catholics in the North support, and which would have most to gain from power sharing, has now come out and said what it's always believed but preferred not to shout about, that the goal of British government policy should be the reunification of Ireland.
The objective that I would like to see stated is that it is the objective of British policy to bring the two traditions in Ireland together in reconciliation, in harmony, in an agreement, and that, in other words, an agreed Ireland. That's the only sort of unity that matters. Then it is clearly necessary for the British government to put forward a rational policy about Ireland, one which is designed to heal, finally, the conflict in Ireland. Because Britain has left other situations. Ireland is its first colony. It's also now its last.
So the political representatives of 80% of the people of Ireland, North and South, are openly advocating an end to the British involvement in Ireland that began many centuries ago. Originally, Ireland was an independent and wholly Catholic country until England invaded and conquered her people. In the 17th century, England planted a colony of Protestant settlers in the north to control Ulster. After the Civil War, only a handful of the IRA fought on. Today, along the border they seek to eliminate, volunteers of the provisional IRA deploy an M60 machine gun, a recent acquisition in their war against the British. A few days ago, we were directed to this area just across the border in the north, a couple of miles from Crossmaglen. We came across a temporary 8-man IRA roadblock, which they claim to mount from time to time. This is the reality of the border. 300 miles of rolling country, impossible to patrol, impossible to seal with anything short of an iron curtain. Many Protestants in the north believe that Jack Lynch is unwilling, rather than unable, to prevent the provisionals using his territory as a base. His current message is seen as nothing short of collusion. In the end, isn't what you want and what the provisional IRA want exactly the same thing, which is the breaking of the link with Britain?
The provisional IRA perhaps do want the same thing ultimately, but they're going away about it in a way that we abhor.
But the end is the same, the breaking of the link.
The breaking of the link, yes. There's no use in denying that, but we certainly don't approve of the Provo tactics. We want, of course, the same ultimate goal, but we want it in a different way. We want to have it in a way that the people, the majority in the north, can live in friendship and without any fear whatever. Without any fear that their traditions or their rights will be prejudiced because of joining us.
In the end, isn't what you want exactly the same as the Provos want, which is the disengagement of Britain from the North? In the end?
Well, all people in Ireland who are nationalist and seek reunification obviously seek an Ireland in which the Irish people jointly together, by agreement and consent, run their own affairs. That aspiration is there. But I don't think you can equate the attitude we adopt, all the parties in the South, that reunification can and should come about only with the consent of a majority in Northern Ireland, with the Provo attitude, which is to try and bomb them into United Ireland. There couldn't be two more different approaches to the problem.
Rory O'Brady, president of the provisional IRA's political wing, Sinn Féin, is scathing about Jack Lynch's pronouncements.
He has come to see that the departure of the British government and army from Ireland is inevitable. That being so, he wishes to cash in on the struggle. He wishes to cash the cheque that the people's struggle in the north of Ireland have accumulated and be seen as the man who finally evicted the British from Ireland. So he is serving his own political interest in that regard, while, of course, he has been uninvolved in the struggle and, in fact, collaborating with the British forces in Ireland.
But to Ulster Unionists meeting in Belfast last week in the citadel of Ulster Unionism, the Ulster Hall, all Republicans are the same.
That Mr. Lynch's behaviour and statement gave the IRA one of its greatest boosts. Now, this
they see Lynch's words as part of a dark plot to destroy the Union and them. But the faithful are far from downhearted. Under the guidance of their adopted son, Enoch Powell, their six Unionist MPs have skillfully exploited the position in a delicately balanced Parliament at Westminster. They've won the promise that Northern Ireland will be given five extra seats in the House of Commons, most of which the Unionists are expected to win.
and they're flattered too by the attention of the Tories, eager to tempt them back to their old alliance with the Conservative Party. Ulster Unionists have every reason to feel that the link is secure.
Are you confident that the link with Britain is permanent?
At this point in time, I think it's true to say that the link is stronger than it's ever been. I'm quite convinced that it will remain as long as the majority of people in Northern Ireland so desire.
What is the significance of those five extra seats for Northern Ireland?
The significance is that at long last, Northern Ireland is being treated in exactly the same way as the rest of the United Kingdom, and people are no longer going to be able to say, well, you're only a token force, you're not really quite the same as the rest of us. That will no longer apply. We're exactly the same as all the rest of the kingdom.
Do you feel that the link with Britain is secure?
Certainly, yes. Much more secure now than I did a few years ago. I feel that there's a growing understanding in Great Britain and indeed in Western Europe of the Unionist position in Northern Ireland, a realization that the vast majority of people here, not just Protestants, but quite a few Catholics as well, wish to maintain the Union.
Partition was never intended to be permanent.
Well, does that mean that the South of Ireland was meant to be permanently out of the United Kingdom?
South of Ireland was never meant to remain on its own forever. Partition was temporary, historically.
Yes, we hoped that the South of Ireland would recognise the mistake it had made and come back into the United Kingdom.
But not all Protestant politicians are so blandly confident. The Reverend Ian Paisley, whose flock is fed with fears of a papish takeover from Dublin, is convinced that Britain intends to pull out of Northern Ireland, and in evidence, recalls a private meeting with Jim Callaghan in the Mayfair Hotel in London, when the Prime Minister laid his cards on the table. Downing Street says the meeting took place 7 years ago, but has no recollection of this exchange.
Mr. Callaghan came to meet us in a London hotel. And one part of that conversation is burned into my memory. I wrote it down, I quote it as he said it. He said, sooner or later, some British government will sell Ulster to the Republic. My advice to you men is make your peace with Dublin now. That is the present Prime Minister, and that is his policy. Ulster is not for sale, and Ulster will never, never be surrendered.
Dr. Paisley?
Yes.
What is your reaction to what Mr. Lynch has been saying?
My reaction is that Mr. Lynch has simply the same objectives as the IRA. He wants a united Ireland. The SDLP, Mr. Lynch, and the IRA have the same objectives. If the link is broken, Ulster would have to go on its own.
Independent.
Independent. But that is a decision that the British government has to make, not us.
And Andy Tyrie, leader of the main Protestant paramilitary force, the UDA, shares Paisley's fears.
The people here don't want to break the link, but they feel that they're being brainwashed until the idea of the link is being broke. It's a feeling they've got, you know, that nobody can say and lift the book off the shelf and say, here is the British plan for Ulster. But they have a feeling within themselves. They relate it to Malaya, Singapore, Gibraltar and all the different places, even Rhodesia. And they feel they're being let down and undermined. So we are just waiting patiently on the day when Dr. Owens flies in and sits down and talks to the terrorists behind our back, because he's already done it in Rhodesia. It's a feeling the people have, but there is a British withdrawal. It's very, very hard to explain. And all the talking Mr. Lynch is doing is not going to reassure them. He's going to have to do a bit more than that.
And Mr. Lynch has a lot to do. Even if the Protestants of the North were to come to terms with a British withdrawal, there are generations of mistrust to overcome before they would come to terms with him. The Republic's constitution is a major obstacle. It claims a legal right to Ulster, and it prohibits divorce. Further, the Roman Catholic Church still wields special influence in the South, and the sale of contraceptives is illegal. So, Mr. Lynch accepts the need for change.
We have said again and again that any change must be a peaceful one. And being a peaceful one, it must be an agreed one. And I want to repeat again that there is no question whatever of compulsion or coercion. If they did ultimately consider whether or not they could join with us in a form or forms of administration, and that would be for discussion and agreement ultimately, then we could change the constitution of Ireland to make it apply to in all Ireland situation, and to be applicable and I hope acceptable in the north as it would be in the south.
If Protestant fears can be calmed and the task is enormous, what kind of Irish unity is on offer? Prime Minister Lynch is being deliberately vague, anxious to keep all his options open. But behind such phrases as unity by consent and agreed Ireland lies the more positive idea of a federation between North and South. It appears that all the Irish political parties would be prepared to guarantee Protestant freedoms by giving Ulster its own parliament with considerable powers within a federation.
The feeling is that we'll arrive at a federal or confederal solution in which each part of the country would have a system of government of its own for those purposes which are relevant to it, and which at the federal confederal level matters to be dealt with, which are in the interest of all better dealt with at that level, just as in the EEC you have certain matters dealt with at the EEC level, others at the national level. But beyond expressing that personal opinion, I don't want to go into details before we get down to work on this.
Dr. Fitzgerald is reluctant to be more specific, but if there were a federal structure and Ulster had its own local parliament, as it used to have at Stormont, would the SDLP still insist on power sharing in that government?
If we reach the circumstances of an agreed Ireland, power sharing in the form that it has been known already would hardly be necessary, because if you had reached agreement, then the problem is solved.
So Protestants could have a Stormont-type parliament back again?
As part of an agreed Ireland, it's a Stormont-type parliament as part of an agreed Ireland and negotiated as part of an agreed Ireland is one way which I believe could guarantee the protection that the Protestant once protected, and it's one option that I believe could be discussed and I would think would find agreement.
And you wouldn't insist on power sharing in that parliament?
In those circumstances, no.
Is one of the things that you consider an Irish federation where the Protestants in the north would have their own parliament in which they had a majority without power sharing, as long as it was part of some sort of Irish federation, that their rights were guaranteed within their own particular state?
Well, I certainly would not rule that out by any means, and it's there, it would be on the table again. It's not a precondition, as I said. It's there for debate, discussion, and ultimately agreement, if we can come to an agreement on this. I wouldn't rule that possibility out at all.
Do you think that anything that Mr. Lynch says is worth considering?
Not really. We are part of the United Kingdom for three reasons. Loyalty to the throne, financial reasons, and thirdly, our fear of the role of the Church of Rome in Southern Ireland.
Would you be at all interested in discussing a loose Irish federation in which Ulster was a semi-autonomous state within the federation with its own majority parliament, without power sharing, in which the rights and the liberties of Protestants were guaranteed?
Certainly not, because this would remove our prime objective, which is to remain loyal to the throne. This would separate us from the British sovereignty, from the United Kingdom. We're not interested in these type of ideas, and I do wish that Mr. Lynch would stop wasting his time on matters of that nature and instead concentrate on the issues of importance.
Federation might be more acceptable to Protestants were it not also the political aim of the provisional IRA. But the attitude of unionists like John Taylor makes Jack Lynch even more convinced that there can be no change in unionist thinking until Britain removes the prop that sustains them. Only then will the deadlock be broken.
Their attitude is largely based on the fact that they feel they have a statutory guarantee from the British government that as long as they remain intransigent into any change, then they're perfectly entitled to what they like in this respect. And all history indicates that the British government, the then British government, and I'm sure the present British government, never foresaw that the situation would not change and that there would be a permanent statelet in the north of Ireland.
The reason why the British won't make a political move is that they believe that the IRA must be defeated first. That, they say, is the key to a peaceful settlement. But the provisionals do not accept that their campaign is making a settlement less likely.
But you have to persuade the million Protestants to look towards Ireland rather than towards Britain. And at the moment, you're just driving them deeper and deeper into the Union.
This is the old argument. The keys to peace. There is a British key to peace, there is a Loyalist key to peace, and there is a Republican key to peace. And the argument is as to which key should be inserted in the door first. The Republican view is that the British key must be inserted first, so that political movement can take place again, because we now have a log jam, we now have a deadlock, and that the British should begin to move in the direction of stating their public intention of leaving Ireland.
It is significant that the only political movement amongst Protestants at the moment is coming from the paramilitaries, who believe that Britain will break the link and are making their plans accordingly. If the link is broken, the paramilitaries favour independence, but Andy Tyrie realises that an independent Ulster could not stand in isolation.
So we're going to have to be dependent on somebody. We can't just be totally independent. And there's no reason why there couldn't be a good relationship with the governments down south, the governments in England, the governments everywhere. That could be developed, it could be worked for our own benefit, there's no doubt about it, because it would have to be done. It would have to be a good relationship for the safeguard of the border. For loads of reasons there should be a good relationship. I say, possibly there was a federation, if that was the solution the Ulster people did choose. Well, I think it could be worked. I think there's enough people down south which could work a good system.
A federation, for example, is something that at least merits discussion.
At this stage, everything is worth looking at, so it is, really is. A federation system would give us our own government back here, would give us our say, it would give us involvement in all of the island, where at the minute the only people that seems to have the say in Ulster is the British government and the Dublin government.
Interestingly, the ORC opinion poll for Ulster Television showed that 62% of the people of Northern Ireland want a special relationship with the South. But for all the talk of unity and federation, the political realities are different. With the prospect of Northern Ireland being given 5 extra seats at Westminster, the political current seems to be flowing towards further integration with the United Kingdom rather than unity with the South, a prospect which worries Jack Lynch.
Mr. Callaghan, in my meeting with him in Downing Street, very categorically said that there was not a scintilla of move towards integration, because I believe if there were, then that would exacerbate the position in the north, and I'm afraid it wouldn't be conducive to finding a peaceful solution, and certainly not conducive to eliminate the violence that unfortunately has been with us now for almost 10 years.
And integration is only likely to fuel the provisionals' campaign.
How long will the war last?
Well, taking the view in historical perspective, the war has gone on for 800 years. There have been uneasy periods of patched up peace. But I believe that the present phase will continue until the British government makes up its mind and declares so in public that it's leaving Ireland for good.
Ever present, too, is the threat of violence from the Protestant side. It comes from organisations such as this, Men of the Protestant Ulster Freedom Fighters, the UFF, the group responsible for many of the sectarian murders of recent years. For 12 months, the Protestant assassination squads, through necessity or choice, have remained inactive. But as the provisionals step up their offensive, pressure for retaliation grows. Yesterday, 2 Catholics were shot dead in Armagh. The police believe the killings were the work of Protestant extremists. Despite the renewal of violence, despite Jack Lynch's overtures, there are no signs that this British government, or any other, has any intention of pulling out of Northern Ireland. Nor is there any sign of further initiatives from Westminster. John Hume despairs.
Do you detect any change in political thinking at Westminster?
No, I don't. I don't detect any political thinking at Westminster about the Northern Ireland problem. What I detect there is a wish to stagger through, and on the government side, a wish to stay in office, and tacking in one direction and another, and in regard to the Northern Ireland problem, doing nothing that's going to upset that. On the opposition side, their spokesman has blatantly played the orange card, again, using the Northern Ireland situation politically for the political benefits of their own party, seem to have learnt nothing from history, because that's where we come in. But basically, no political thinking going on there. They just throw up their hands in horror if anybody suggests a new option.
Britain remains as deeply involved as ever in Northern Ireland. The only political initiative has come from Jack Lynch. The British government's reaction to that is one of silent irritation. In the emergency debate on Northern Ireland in the House of Commons this week, there were never more than 50 MPs in the chamber out of a total of 632. The speeches were about security, not politics. Northern Ireland sometimes seems more like the dark side of the moon than part of the United Kingdom.